Welcome back, Doctor. Safe to do so. In 100 meters, turn right. In 200 meters, you will arrive at your destination. You have arrived at your destination.
It's freezing out there. We've still got loads of people braving the weather to watch this seasonal. I don't suppose that has anything to do with you, does it?
Turn right. Turn right. arrived at your destination.
This is Project EAT. That's EAT for E-Class All Terrain. It's a modified Merc built by the Top Gear magazine team for finding bears in the woods. Not many bears around here, though. Mostly badgers. Still, there's definitely some terrain. Lots of it. All you need is a good sense of direction. Or not. Here's Stig again, looking lost. Terrified of maps, apparently. Inner compass points directly south. The EAT has a silky smooth V6 diesel. It'll do 155 miles an hour on the road, but where we're going, we won't need roads. First up, it's a trip to the top of Glen Rannoch, by any means necessary, and against the clock, naturally. But don't worry, it has knobbly tyres, and a roof rack for carrying extra knobbly tyres.
In 400 metres, turn left.
Says you need an SUV to go off-road. The EAT has four-wheel drive and air suspension to smooth out lumps and bumps and everyday obstacles. Ancient burial mounds, for example.
Turn sharp left. Turn sharp left. In 200 meters, turn right. Turn right. In 200 meters, turn left. Turn left. In 400 meters, turn sharp left. Turn sharp left.
It also has 340 horsepower, more torque than a cruise ship, and gets to 60 miles an hour in just over 5 seconds.
Turn right.
Some proper hang time, actual air suspension. Now it's time to head way over there, to the very top of Arthur's Seat. But first, what goes up must come down.
Meters, turn left. Meters, Turn left. Turn left.
It's full of home comforts, the EAT. Charges for almost anything you can charge. Cozy ambient lighting, even a portable espresso machine. Everything the intrepid explorer could ever need.
At the roundabout, take the first exit. Meters, turn right. Turn right.
All right, all this adventure kit's had a tiny effect on the fuel efficiency. Good job the roof rack holds 2 cans of diesel, and there's another one in the back. Just don't confuse them with your drinking water.
Take the first exit.
On to the final stretch now. Just the small matter of getting up Arthur's seat. The clock's ticking, so better step on it, Stiggy. Well, it is a Mercedes wagon, so it's tough. And if you really want to smash stuff up, there's even a pickaxe in the back.
100 meters. Turn left.
There we go, the top of Arthur's seat. No idea who Arthur is, by the way, or why his seat's so big. Nice view, though. Shame there's no time to stick around. Now, I said we'd be driving some British classics, and you don't get more British than a car built in Birmingham designed by a man from Greece. Anyway, here it is, an original Mini Cooper S, an icon of 60s engineering. It was designed for cities, but this is the wide-body one, so we're going to need a bit more room. And I know just the place. Ready, Stig? The Mini is cleverly packaged, capable of carrying 4 people and their luggage. Hand luggage, presumably. Cooper S was the car to beat on the famous Monte Carlo rally. It pretty much wiped the floor with the competition.
the roundabout, take the third exit.
The Cooper S was developed by a bloke called John Cooper, who also built F1 cars, so it had real racing pedigree. And it wasn't just Monte Carlo either. The British Saloon Car Championship, the Thousand Lakes Rally, even the Australian Touring Car Championship. Almost any time the Mini turned up, it won.
In 100 metres, turn left. In 400 metres, turn right. Turn right. Turn left.
Here we are! Told you it was spacious. We've got everything we need here. An airfield, the original rapid runabout, and the Stig. I'm looking forward to this. Look at that! Laying down some rubber there. Not that it has much to lay. After all, tiny wheels mean tiny tyres. Now that's just showing off. What is it with minis and shipping containers? They sold nearly 5.5 million minis. But only this one could fly, apparently. Mini punches well above its weight. It's literally unstoppable. Forget rallying, this thing was made for demolition derbies. Lovely work there. Short wheelbase, front wheel drive. It's really not an easy car to slide, this. Someone tell the Stig we're done now. It's time for a spot of sightseeing.
Passed on your details to someone called Hans Liebold. He's the guy the insurance company sends to test anything related to cars, and Hans takes his job very seriously. You should go meet him. You'll love it.
Here we are then, Edinburgh, where it's time for a spot of turbocharged tourism with this, the mighty Porsche GT2 RS. All we need now is our tour guide, McStig, the world's worst Scotsman, allergic to tartan, absolutely petrified of bagpipes, or so I've heard. Right, let's see if we can visit every bell tower in Edinburgh and get back here before they all stop ringing.
In 400 metres, turn left. Turn left.
What a car this is. 3.8-litre flat-six, two turbos, 700 horsepower, all wrapped up in carbon fibre with wings, stripes, holes and vents for snorting in the air.
At the roundabout, take the first exit.
Excellent hooliganry. That's what 700 horsepower and rear-wheel drive will do for you if you have the guts for it and an effective laundry detergent. Nippy little thing, isn't it? 0 to 60 takes 2.7 seconds. Just the job for a bit of speedy sightseeing. Ooh, inch perfect there. It's wider than a regular 911, this GT2, and about 20 times more terrifying. Basically, the perfect device for nipping in and out of city traffic.
In 400 metres, turn right.
It might be street legal, but it's only a pair of fireproof underpants away from being a full-blown racing car.
In 200 metres, turn right. Turn right. Turn right. The roundabout, take the second exit.
It's a real masterpiece of engineering, this GT2 RS. The wheels are made from magnesium, the exhaust is titanium. It's exotic, savage, and utterly bonkers. I love it!
In 200 meters, turn left. Turn left. In 200 meters, turn sharp right. Turn sharp right.
It's limited to 211 miles an hour. Any faster and it would need special tyres. But with the stick behind the wheel, who knows?
At the roundabout, take the first exit.
Into the final stretch now. Note to Stig, remember to park properly at the end. And watch out for traffic wardens. Take as long as you like. I've got nothing else to do. Right, let's see if we can visit every bell tower in Edinburgh and get back here before they all stop ringing.
In 400 metres, turn left.
Ooh, inch perfect there. It's wider than a regular 911, this GT2, and about 20 times more terrifying. Basically, the perfect device for nipping in and out of city traffic. What a car this is. 3.8-litre flat-six, two turbos, 700 horsepower, all wrapped up in carbon fibre with wings, stripes, holes and vents for snorting in the air.
At the roundabout, take the first exit.
Nippy little thing, isn't it? 0 to 60 takes 2.7 seconds. Just the job for a bit of speedy sightseeing.
In 400 meters, turn right.
It might be street legal, but it's only a pair of fireproof underpants away from being a full-blown racing car.
In 200 metres, turn right. Turn right. Turn right. At the roundabout, take the second exit.
It's a real masterpiece of engineering, this GT2 RS. The wheels are made from magnesium, the exhaust is titanium. It's exotic, savage, and utterly bonkers. I love it!
In 100 meters, turn left. In 200 meters, turn sharp right. Turn sharp right.
It's limited to 211 miles an hour. Any faster and it would need special tyres. But with the stick behind the wheel, who knows?
Turn right. At the roundabout, take the first exit.
Into the final stretch now. Note to Stig, remember to park properly at the end. And watch out for traffic wardens. Good work! Hard on those carbon ceramic brakes now. They could stop a locomotive dead in its tracks. I told you we'd finish with a fan's favourite, and here it is. No, not the lorry. The thing on the back, under the tarp. You'll love it. But first, we need to move it into position. Thankfully, we have our very own haulage expert, a trucker's trucker. No load too large. Yes, it's Big Rig Stig. Right, now take it easy, Stig. That's some expensive cargo you have back there. Costs as much as a house. And weighs about the same, too. Worked out what it is yet? Okay, here are some cryptic clues. It's all-wheel drive, but not four-wheel drive. It's a wagon, but you definitely don't need a horse to pull it.
In 200 meters, turn left. Turn left.
That's 5 tons of flatbed carrying 4 tons on its back. Don't you just hate getting stuck behind a slow, lumbering old... Wait a minute, it's actually accelerating. Up a hill. I guess that's what 900 foot-pounds of torque does for you. That plus trucker Stig. Almost there. Just park it up and we'll whip those covers off. Good job, Big Rig Stig. Suits you, you know. Although, come to think of it, maybe pickups are more your style. Especially the one we have in store. I give you the Mercedes G63 AMG 6x6. It's the ultimate off-roader, a 4-ton, 6-wheel sports utility truck. Basically, a G-Wagon with the back half of a pickup thrown in for free. Up front is a 5.5-litre twin-turbo V8. Usually it's limited to 100 miles an hour, but not this one.
In 100 metres, turn right.
Oh, someone call air traffic control. I'm pretty sure you need a special license to fly one of these. With all of the wheels comes all of the grip. The 6x6 turns mountains into motorways. Is there anything it can't conquer?
In 100 meters, turn left. In 400 meters, turn left. Turn left.
It makes 536 horsepower and more than 760 newton meters of torque. With that speed limiter removed, and with the stick behind the wheel, it'll do 125 miles an hour, with a bit of a run-up.
In 100 metres, turn right.
It's tough, the 6x6. After all, it was originally made for the Australian Army. It's basically a tank with heated seats.
In 400 metres, turn left. Turn left.
It can wade through a metre of water, this thing. Most cars need full scuba kit at that depth. Ridiculous!
In 200 metres, turn left. Turn left.
Top job there, Stig. Take tomorrow off. No idea what Stig does with his day off. Experimental dance? Goat yoga? Bog snorkeling? Anyway, I've been Chris Harris, and I still am, and this has been the Top Gear Horizons special. Thanks for coming. Now, let's go see what this Fortsathon live thing's all about. This is Project EAT. That's EAT for E-Class All Terrain. It's a modified Merc built by the Top Gear magazine team for finding bears in the woods. Not many bears around here, though. Mostly badgers. Still, there's definitely some terrain. Lots of it. All you need is a good sense of direction. Or not. Here's Stig again, looking lost. Terrified of maps, apparently. Inner compass points directly south. EAT has a silky smooth V6 diesel. It'll do 155 miles an hour on the road, but where we're going, we won't need roads. First up, it's a trip to the top of Glen Rannoch, by any means necessary, and against the clock, naturally. But don't worry, it has knobbly tyres. And a roof rack for carrying extra knobbly tyres.
At the roundabout, take the third exit. Turn around when it is safe to do so. Meters. Turn left. Turn left. Recalculating route. Arrived at your destination.
Very nice, am I right? Hans has got a consultancy out here testing cars. He's a brilliant engineer, but not much of a driver. So he's looking for a business partner. Want to join the insurance business? Welcome to the insurance business, eh? You're going to love this.
So, you are the one Joel has sent to help me, yes? My name is Hans Liebold. For 30 years, I designed and built performance vehicles in Germany, but I have come to the festival to pursue a more exciting vocation, insurance. That was a joke. I'm trying to put you at your ease. It seems I have failed. No matter. Let us begin. Now, the claimant in our first case poses an interesting question around acceleration and downforce. Now, if you would kindly take this Volkswagen Type 2 and attempt to make it take off.
I assure you this is theoretically possible, given sufficient speed. I have set your navigation. It appears I have forgotten to close the roads to traffic. But we must reproduce conditions as closely as possible, yes? So the claim is disproved. The Volkswagen Type 2 cannot fly. But to be truthful, I'm not surprised by the results of this experiment. But you will learn I'm nothing if not Sarah.
Hello! I'm pleased to see you again. Not merely for professional purposes, but also because of our developing social connection. Now, this is a BMW iSetter. For its size, it is deceptively powerful and also highly maneuverable, though I think perhaps not so maneuverable for the claimant who delivered theirs into the back of a furniture truck.
So, if you would please test the iSetter's ability to navigate traffic whilst avoiding collisions. For the experiment and for your own safety, of course. So, if you would please test the iSetter's ability to navigate traffic whilst avoiding collisions. For the experiment and for your own safety, of course. And so the claim is disproved. With sufficient driver applications, the BMW iSetter may navigate even dense traffic. I will inform the claimant that they must simply try harder.
Our next case involves an outlandish claim and a vehicle with something of a reputation here in Britain, which I believe to be undeserved. You know this, the Reliant Supervan. With some small stability enhancements, this design, in my opinion, is quite sound.
You will proceed, please, to Bamborough Castle, where we will attempt a small and highly scientific jump.
In 400 meters, turn left. In 100 meters, you will arrive at your destination. In 200 meters, turn right.
Good. Now, to recreate the conditions of the accident which resulted in a claim for damages to a church roof.
You see, the fiberglass construction makes the Reliance Supervan light enough to become airborne. It lacks, I think, in aerodynamics and engine power. For this next test, I have compensated, perhaps overcompensated. We shall see.
To me that I have added no additional safety features, but at least you will be landing on sand. It worked. I mean, of course it worked. And so we see that it is entirely possible to deposit a Reliant Superfan in the belfry of a country church. I will contact the claimant and pass on the good news. Well, the results anyway.
Do you know that in my spare time, I am an avid watcher of films? Oh yes, one of my favorite films sees young people having personal revelations whilst racing classic cars. See if you can tell what it is. Now, one of my claimants has apparently tried to recreate scenes of the film, which features a Morris Minor similar to this one, with limited success.
We will require city conditions and traffic lights. So, Edinburgh, if you please.
In 400 meters, turn left. Turn left.
Is not so much like the California of the film, but perhaps we can use our imaginations. Well done, you have achieved the optimal result for the first part of our test, which is, I'm not so sure, this is a uniquely American word, but cruising, I think, yes?
Now we must test the drag race performance of the Morris Minor with a few small engine modifications of my own. This is not strictly reproducing conditions of the film, but nor is the speed trap we are borrowing from the Horizon Festival.
Now, straight line speed is our object. If it helps, you may imagine you are racing against an impossibly handsome actor. Excellent. I will advise the claimants that they may be confident lining up against an Austin Healey sprite, as in the film. Once that Morris Minor returns from the crash repairer, of course.
I must confess, I was confused by our next case involving a racing truck. I was not aware of such a term. I had to consult with Horizon to find a suitable test vehicle. Though I was not disappointed with the result. Perhaps before we begin testing, you would like a chance to, how do you say, get a feel for this machine?
In 100 meters, turn right. In 400 meters, turn right. Turn right. In 400 meters, turn left. Turn left. In 400 meters, turn right. Turn right.
Very good. Unlike our claimant, you have passed the first test. The vehicle is not upside down.
Our claimant insists that these so-called high-performance heavy vehicles are simply too fast to manage variable terrain. We will attempt not only to prove otherwise, but to demonstrate they are much faster when kept firmly on the road.
You may feel an urge to go off-road, despite my carefully plotted route, you will please resist this urge. Much improved acceleration over flat ground. Enhanced traction through tight corners, yes. Also, I must congratulate you on your restraint. Downhill roads provide increased downforce as well as speed. Interesting. You see, we may dispute the claim that the racing truck cannot be controlled. Indeed, if yours was refrigerated, you could quite easily deliver milk or eggs or other perishable goods.
My friend, did you know that video footage of our investigations is highly sought after around the festival? I was not aware so many young people were considering insurance as a career. In any case, we have a new claim and a new test vehicle, perfect for scouting our new test location. Please enjoy the scenery as well as the performance.
Turn around when it is safe to do so. In 100 meters, turn sharp left. Turn right. In 200 meters, turn sharp right. Turn sharp right. In 100 meters, turn sharp left. Thank you. turn left.
Please notice the superior grip and downforce on tight turns. Also, these woods are nice.
Calculating route. Turn right.
Notice the improved acceleration as we pass the dam. A little of my handiwork. The acceleration, not the dam.
In 200 meters, turn left. Turn left. In 400 meters, turn right. Turn right.
The vehicle is performing well, yes? Good. You should be approaching the quarry now.
Calculating route. In 400 meters, turn left.
So, what do you think? A suitable location for a machine as rugged as this, yes?
Now, allow me to explain. Our claimant has explored this very quarry in a Willis MB, similar to ours, though they have expressed dissatisfaction with their performance upgrades. Through a combination of my work and your skill, we will now set about, very politely, proving them wrong. May I suggest a more aggressive approach to navigation?
You see the sat-nav? Please ignore this.
In 400 meters, turn left.
I will make it known to their client that the Willis MB is more than adequate to their purposes of vertical movement and visceral excitement.
Hello, good day. How are you? Now that we have enjoyed the small talk, we may proceed to the next case, involving an acceleration test in normal traffic conditions. Now, this is a 1966 Volkswagen Beetle, into which I have placed a 2.5-liter F4 turbo engine, partly to replicate the conditions of the claim, but also because I would very much like to see what happens.
Perhaps be careful with this vehicle. I may have overdone it. Actually, you know, the claim concerns a driver very much overdoing it. So by all means, how is it you say, put the foot down. Another case closed, though I must say, I like this claimant. All those years working in Germany, never once did I think to do this to a Volkswagen.
Our next claimant extensively modified a 1955 Chevy 150 utility sedan, with a view to turning it into a rally car. This is not so far beyond the realms of possibility. The vehicle is heavy, yes, but with all-wheel drive and rally-tuned springs and dampers, it could be done. The claimant's attempt resulted, of course, in complete failure, but I am confident that ours will not.
Turn around when it is safe to do so. In 100 meters, turn sharp left. Turn right. In 200 meters, turn sharp right. Turn sharp right. In 100 meters, turn sharp left. meters. Turn right. Turn right. It is safe to do so. At the roundabout, take the second exit. Meters, turn right. Turn right. In 400 meters, turn left. Turn left. Meters, turn right. Turn right. In 400 meters, turn left. Turn left. Turn around when it is safe to do so.
All in all, a highly adequate rally car. And we should not discount the psychological effect upon the competition of being overtaken by a collector's item.
Ah, greetings once again. So, we have our modified Chevy 150. Now we must test the claim that it will make a competitive rally car. I am confident in the vehicle's performance, and I have observed enough of your experimental driving technique to be confident in you also.
Ah, now, you will need a co-driver, of course. This will be me. Steady incline, four-wheel drive, hold the rear end tight. That did not sound as it should. You see how those wide tires and reduced weight handle the corners? The claimant failed to grasp this. Rough ground. Trust the improved suspension. Hard left now. Stay on the road. Now, on the decline. Suspension, braking, and steady nerves. Such power in the big Chevrolet engine. This the claimant grasped a little too well, I think. Yeah, most satisfactory. Yourself and the car. The claimant will be pleased to know we have succeeded where they catastrophically failed. Or perhaps they will not.
Have you noticed an upward trend in peculiar insurance cases since we began our work? I have noticed this. Is it possible we are, how would you say, a bad influence? And here is one such case. The claimant wishes to establish the absolute maximum capabilities and tolerances of the Myers Manx Dune buggy.
Well, if test the Dune buggy we must, then test the Dune buggy we will. This will make a prime testing location. I think also away from prying eyes. I knew insurance would be difficult. I did not know it would be so popular.
Now, the Manx here has been outfitted with the latest accelerometers, lateral G-force meters, and impact sensors. I will be using the data to build a detailed telemetric profile. All I require from you is that you drive like you have no concern for your own safety.
Please accept as a token of my esteem that I think this will not be so difficult a task for you. Thank you. I would describe this performance as slightly unbalanced, but certainly not unsafe. So, we have successfully established the tolerances of the Myers Manx. To what end, I'm not sure. We have received no claims of damage to dune buggies, except perhaps our own.
I'm afraid this case represents our last together as colleagues and work-related social companions. For the moment, as long as there is insurance, my friend, there will be bizarre insurance claims. For example, this claimant placed a 2.6-liter rotary engine inside a production Mazda Miata MX-5. As you are aware, this type of engine is more common in high-performance propeller-driven aircraft.
If you'd please take it and ascertain just how badly this can go wrong. The first phase of testing will be along standard country roads with mild undulations next to the coast. The data is adequate but incomplete. Please do not concern yourself with the howling noise. This is quite normal. Endeavor to gather more information, please. Good. Now for the urban testing phase. You will please take into account traffic and various asphalt conditions. Please avoid collisions with urban vehicles. In the highway testing phase. Please exceed 200 miles an hour along this section for optimum data gathering. Well done. But I feel we would gain further illumination with further acceleration. Do you not think so? testing. My calculations suggest a performance of this kind should result in total spontaneous engine disassembly. And yet, here you are. Well, I must say, whether the claim was proved or disproved, it was a great deal of fun, and I have you to thank. I know you are busy at the festival. I'm sure I will see more of you. But if you should ever leave, I hope you will consider a career in insurance.
Hans might not show it, but he's grateful. Really. He loves setting up test conditions, but he hates driving.
Ha ha!